Hello, and welcome back to another episode of Podcasting is Praxis. My name is Rob, and my pronouns are he and him.
I'm Jamie, and my pronouns are he and him.
And we have a guest recording grab bag for you this evening. That's because a lot of us are, literally everybody else is out with the lurgy. So for the first section, we're going to be joined by my partner, Tracy.
Hi, I'm Tracy, pronouns she, her.
And then in the second part, we're joined by Dr. Phil Burton-Cartledge, who's a lecturer at sociology at Derby University and the author of The Party's Over. And we're going to be talking with him about the fate of the Tory party before cutting back to us and Tracy to do comment or commentariat. And if that makes no sense at all, don't worry. We've spent half an hour trying to figure this out anyway. Anyway, thank you, Darth.
The vibe is in shambles.
Yeah.
This is shambles? This isn't normal?
Yeah. For us, it was Tuesday.
For me too.
Shall we talk about some things? Shall we specifically talk about the latest proposals from the Labour Party to make a line go up and to make economy go? And that is, as part of the investment summit, the drug maker Eli Lilly is going to invest $280 million in the UK to develop new drugs and treatments. And specifically, those treatments will be to get you fat people back into the workforce ASAP.
Yeah. Just what I've always wanted.
So, yeah, I said, the part of this is a plan. This is from the article in The Telegraph, where, of course, this was released. Quote, the plan will include the first real-world trial of the drug's effect on worklessness, productivity, and reliance on the NHS.
What?
Okay. What, but,
so, basically, what they're doing is, this is like... Eli Lilly, which is a huge, huge American pharma conglomerate, will get to piggyback on the NHS and like do a 5-year pilot study on how their like weight loss drugs affect the economy if you give it to about 3,000 NHS patients, I think, in the greater Manchester area.
Yeah.
Manchester area only. They want to do a study only in Manchester. And that's their study.
The study is run by the NHS. With Eli Lilly. So like I don't know the details of like the trial structure, but I assume that if it's run through the NHS, it has some level of clinical rigor, and also they want to like involve 3,000 people.
So this is the thing Streeting was like rattling on about this morning, then, was it, with the Ozempic or whatever it is to get like people back to work.
Yeah, so Ozempic is the one that's made by the main competitor. That's made by Novo Nordisk. That's the one that's like really broadly available that everybody's talking about. And I think part of the reason that like this one is being rolled out and also in this investment summit in everything is because like the Eli Lilly one has only just been approved for use in the UK, and like what better way to get it into the NHS and like known to the brand recognition than like to get your way into the new Starmer government.
Yeah, but this is this trial where he was talking about we've got to give it to like unemployed people.
Yes, because that's what the Telegraph meant by the drug's effect on worklessness.
Mm-hmm.
which is
did you see so yesterday he was talking about how he was warning people against using this drug for an Instagram body because of the side effects and the fact that the NHS is struggling to maintain supplies of it.
Yes.
Yeah.
But
so, you know what I mean? Please don't use up all of the supplies because, you know, A, it's dangerous, but B, the NHS needs that to give to the jobless. Yeah.
Who are all fat, apparently. Because you can't be jobless and thin or healthy.
Yeah, I mean, the cynical reasoning is, of course, something like, you know, Amazon doesn't like it when their workers are too obese because it slows down the order picking, I think, is, you know, probably the way you should be looking at that.
I mean, This government just seems to have like the idea, the way they carry on, you would think there was not a single healthy person in the country out of work. You would think every single person who doesn't have a job is like on medical leave, you know?
Well, I mean, that's part of
every policy they've announced so far about, like, you know, getting people back into work has been, well, you can't have benefits for mental health. We need to put like a job center in the hospital. We need to give like obese people an injection to make them thin so they can find a job. It's like, you know, there are people out of work who are relatively healthy, you know?
But it's also depressing because it's like what you reference is like benefits because of mental health.
Yeah.
And it's also somehow implying that people have mental health issues because of their weight. And therefore, if we solve that, will we solve the mental health issue? Like, it's so reductive.
Yeah. It's also like kind of weird because, like I say, so far, I think every intervention they've listed, every intervention I can think of off the top of my head that they've suggested for the unemployed has revolved around like disability or illness or mental health. But if you've ever tried to claim benefits in the UK, the entire like job centre apparatus is set up to try and like fight against the idea that you might be unfit for work. So what exactly are they offering all of the people who, you know, are out of work because of a disability or an illness or mental health, but who aren't given those benefits because, you know, they got like knocked back by Atos or whoever's fucking doing it now, and therefore, like, you know, being forced to look for work? Or is that just fine that they're like, you know, because I think that's the thing where it's like, we want to get like people back to work, you know, we're going to make people thin so they can go back to work, we're going to turn off mental health benefits so you go back to work. They don't really, unless they're gonna, you know what I mean, unless they're gonna like do some planned economy shit, they don't really have a way to guarantee that you will get back to work. What they mean is that they're going to get you back to looking for work, which,
yeah,
you know, is the real issue. If you're looking for work for your if you're on benefits and you're looking for work to keep those benefits, then they get to harass you as much as possible, and it's really unpleasant. But if you've got like the bit of paper that you probably had to go to an appeal to get that says, no, this person does actually have a disability or other you know thing that would prevent them from looking for work, then they have to leave you largely alone, and that's the bit we can't abide.
No, I mean, this sort of fits into it sort of fits into that for sure. It also fits into like, I can't remember the amount of governments I've seen in a row who, because it was also in, it was even in like the Leveling Up white paper, like in 2019, and I know Blair was at it and Cameron was at it, that like, so the basic problem with the unemployed, so far as I know, or like Britain in general, is that like, is obesity. And it's like, I'm not saying that there's not a problem with obesity in the UK, but I'm just saying that like, if your answer to the problem of obesity can be reduced to, well, we're gonna like get the NHS in bed with this giant drug maker to give them one drug and not fix any of the socioeconomic circumstances that might make people obese or make people, you know, mentally unfit for work, or, you know, have any of the other many legitimate things, it's like it goes back to the old, you know, the problem's very, very bad, but the cause is very, yeah, very good.
Well, I mean, that's the thing, like it's the same old thing though, isn't it? It's like, if you want to address the root causes of like obesity and joblessness and anything else in Britain, whether it's like, you know, like crime or the smell of weed coming in through your child's bedroom window and making them fail the GCSEs, or, you know, whatever fucking like particular boogeyman the Labour right are up against this week. Really, they're a lot like Buffy the Vampire Slayer, and it's a different monster every week for them, isn't it? You know what I mean? It's
I love that.
But whatever it is that they're currently like shadow boxing, they can't address the root causes, because the root causes are like inequality and, you know, maybe people don't
shit
teaching
wages and bad
wages, like long hours, shit public transport, so you've got to commute for like 4 hours a day, just all these things. And you know what I mean, like go all the way back to like school, like, you know, when we were at school we didn't learn fuck all about cooking. That was, you know what I mean, like, because that was that back then it was like, well, you know, at first when I first started school, they didn't even teach us like home economics or whatever they were calling it back then. It was just for the girls. And then halfway through secondary school, you know, right, all the lads have got to do it now as well because of woke. And then, like, you know, they still didn't teach us anything fucking useful. You know what I mean? It's like,
I know.
Oh, how many you can burn a peanut to find out how many calories are in it. I'm like, okay, when is that going to be useful?
But that sounds more like science. I remember distinctly having an entire lesson learning how to make what was called Roman toast, which was basically toast with honey on it. That was an hour and 10 minutes of my life I will never get back.
And yet, darling, I have never received from you a single slice of Roman toast.
And neither you shall.
But, you know, addressing all of these issues requires, like, systemic change. And as a general rule, you can't patent systemic change. But you can patent one injection that makes you thin and then hopefully gets you back to work. So that's basically you know what I mean? That's our cyberpunk future for us from now on, is we're just going to be subjected to various like interventions that someone makes a lot of money from.
Well, you'll be pleased to know, Jamie, that the sound bite that was like distributed through all the media, because I saw it in like 50 places today, was that this particular drug is known as the King Kong of weight loss drugs.
Oh, is it though?
Oh, yeah, but it's not. It's just the one that happens to be available in the UK. There are others available worldwide that are actually targeted for weight loss. I mean, but this was...
Have those other weight loss drugs climbed up a skyscraper and punched a lot of biplanes?
I don't get the reference, but I'm assuming not.
Well, see, that's the problem.
Sorry.
There's a real marketing gap. Eli Lilly, call us.
Exactly.
We have such sights to
that's
show
you. That's the problem. But yeah, I think you got it on. You hit it on the head, Jamie. I mean, everything that needs changing is hard work. And having a nice flashy headline and, hey, this fancy new drug that all these famous people are taking will make it available to you if you find a job, if you look. And I'm like, what's going to happen? Are they just going to go to the job center for, you know, to claim their benefit and have someone stick a needle in them and say, oh, thank you very much? Like, is that how it's going to work? Like, and then if they get a job, do they then lose access to it?
They're
going to
give the bouncer at the entrance to the job centre Jason Bourne training, so he can just syringe you in the neck when you're not looking.
Oh, yes.
Maybe they can repurpose those what the fuck they called again, the dart guns where that shoot little soft arrows, but like you just like retool them so that you can like shoot weight loss drugs at people at the door.
Yeah, you know what they should do is they should just return to Tony Blair's New Deal, because that was everyone liked that, you know what I mean? It's like people who set up like shady colleges in like a bin that was left unattended for 20 minutes, they loved that, like, you know what I mean? The government who got to reduce the fucking unemployment statistics by like millions potentially because everyone was in a bin learning how to like make a dry stone wall, they loved that. And the people who didn't have to look for work because they were like fucking skiving, you know what I mean? They turned up at like Learning World, signed in at 9 o'clock in the morning, and then wandered into the Metro Center to play Tekken for 8 hours and come back and sign out. They loved that as well. I have it on good authority.
Is having a nice afternoon pint sitting behind the big bin that says Learning World on it.
Yeah. Seriously, it was a win-win-win, you know? Nobody learned anything. Nobody got any useful skills out of it, but it kept everyone busy and it kept the numbers down.
Yeah. We could call it Grouchonomics. Rachel Reeves, call us. But yeah, no, the details of the trial I'm not entirely sure of, because this thing has obviously just been like launched. But the only thing that I can really tell you is that like the NHS has already been using these like weight loss drugs for like very specific patients in very specific cases. But obviously now it's being rolled out much more, you know, overall everywhere in the NHS past these specialized clinics. And it's also going to be made available through what the Telegraph article calls digital consultations, by which I mean pretty much anywhere anybody can get their hands on it, which might actually be a big problem, because like young people and especially young women with like body issue, with body you know, body image issues, to put it that way, like have already been in the hospital because you're really not supposed to take this when you're already like underweight or have other issues. This is like, these are fairly serious drugs still.
You wouldn't know it though if you just glanced at like the headlines in the Daily Mail, for example.
You wouldn't even know it from all of the media and what's available. Like, if you want to educate yourself on this, there are so few studies on, or real testimonials on the negative side effects of these drugs as well. It really irritates me when I tell a vague story about a vague person. But there was a guy who's written a book because he was on it, and then he can't come off it, and telling all the side effects that he experienced, and you know, going off food, and for me that you lose enjoyment in life if you don't enjoy food, and you know, got to a point where he's reliant on it now, like he's been taking it for 2 or 3 years but almost scared to come off it. So there's also no, it's been on the market for a long time, but in the media it's been very prevalent for the last 12 to 24 months, but the longer term impact of this is still not clear.
Longer term impact studies are something you only really need to worry about if you're denying trans people any kind of care. For everyone else, it's just fuck it, we'll figure it out, you know what I mean?
Well, I mean, it's not just going to be like luxury living on, you know, with these new weight loss drugs. Quote again, Wes Streeting in the Telegraph. He wrote an article for it as well. But along with the rights to access these new drugs, there must remain a responsibility on us all to take healthy living more seriously. The NHS cannot always be expected to pick up the tab. So they will only do it to get you into work.
Yeah, obviously. You know what I mean? The NHS can't be expected to treat people. What the fuck do you think this is? Your granny's yacht.
So, I mean, this is also, and also that's the other, that's... Sorry, darling?
Sorry, I go crazy. And I know I'm not very vocal and verbal on this podcast, so I'm a terrible guest, but I'm just here shaking my head in despair, which doesn't translate, I get.
Yeah, but that's like also 90% of this podcast. We've just learned to vocalize our head shaking. But yeah, the other thing that this is, because that's sort of in line with everything else West Reading has been doing, is this is also a signal that the NHS will simply be opened up even further to like commercial purposes and corporate purposes. Specifically, I imagine, because this is a 3000 is a fairly, you know, evolved trial. But you know, the NHS is also an incredible data repository of like an entire developed nation's worth of sick people over many years now. Quote again, Wes Streeting from the Telegraph. The reforms this government will put in place will open the NHS up to work much more closely with life sciences to develop more effective treatments and put the NHS patients at the front of the queue.
Guinea pigs, then.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes,
we've been like, as our family has like been studiously ignoring a series of letters from some bunch of fucking like private health dipshits who are running a trial and want us to like sign up, like, you know, sign up so they can have access to our NHS records. And it's like, no, you can fuck off. Do you know what I mean? So I imagine the next step will be to streamline that process by removing the need for consent.
Yeah, or they'll do that lovely like reverse consent thing where you need to like opt out, but in order to get the paperwork for the opt out, you have to, you know, answer me these riddles three, basically.
Thank you, Brexit. Goodbye, GDPR. And also, there was one amazing sentence there, Rob, where you referenced that, oh, they will have access to data. This is under the assumption that the NHS even has a decent IT infrastructure and that each hospital or county isn't running their own IT centres and that everyone talks to each other. I mean, if you move in the UK, do your records actually go with you digitally, or is it like a long process? I don't even know anymore. But I just know. Recently, my dad unfortunately needed to have an ambulance. And then a couple of months later, he needed another one. And they literally didn't have the records from the first ambulance because the service had been outsourced and was running on a different system and hadn't updated the records. So if you can't keep records within one single hospital, I'm not worried about these companies taking NHS data. I don't believe it's in a decent state to use.
No, I've heard that every single like health trust, and in some cases like individual hospitals, have their own system for like storing the data, and none of them are compatible with each other. And that honestly sounds to me like it's time for another government IT project to straighten that all out.
Yeah. Well, I mean, remember, we did years ago now, I think, like we did that episode with Alistair and his partner, who like who moved NHS trusts, and like just getting her patient files like transferred over was like a 18-month nightmare, basically.
Yeah. But have you considered, though, if they gave enough millions of pounds to some like IT guy, he could like come up with a way to standardize all the information across all of the NHS, and it would probably only take like 10 years and run maybe 3 or 4 times over budget.
Well, I mean, that's a steal at twice the price.
Well, you could argue 280 million. So instead of this, this pilot project with Zempic, and you could consider an IT female, and then maybe it would run in half the time. Just saying.
Yeah. Well, this isn't going to be Ozempic. I should be specific. This is Eli Lilly's Mounjaro, which is apparently, you know, this is the King Kong one. I think it's reported.
All right. All of my previous opinions stand corrected. I apologize.
Yes, you hear that, Eli Lilly? This podcast is open to sponsorship opportunities. No, this is just one more bit before I want to move off this, because this was also reported on in the Guardian, but more in the context of that Starmer Investment Summit, you know, where like we you know, all the corporations are coming back like swallows in summer. But this is a bit, and see if you recognize some familiar names. Quote, concerns about Labour's plans for the NHS may be raised by a session called Unlocking the UK's Health Data Assets to Deliver Innovation, involving the chief executive of NHS England, the head of research of Google's DeepMind AI division, as well as the chair of US pharmaceutical company Eli Lilly. Weird that they're also at the investment summit.
Yeah.
What wonder what that means.
Speaking of the investment summit, by the way, that's the next thing I wanted to talk about. So, like, I don't know. If you were around in the last few days, there was the big Starmer did a big conference, fancy thing, where they ended up announcing how, you know, there's going to be £60 billion of new investments secured by this Labour government. Blah blah blah. You know, just by the way, for a bit of context, UK GDP is 2.7 trillion. So, like, while I'm not denying that £60 billion is a nice amount of money for like some locales, it's also not going to change the country, because, you know, it's still a drop in a very very big bucket.
Yeah.
So, but the thing that I wanted to get at this is like, there's two things. The first thing is, this is a bit from Starmer's speech when he was in the room, and the room was filled with like all the CEOs and all the people you think would be in such a room. Quote, we will make sure that every regulator in this country, especially our economic and competition regulators, takes growth as seriously as this room does.
Okay.
So if this is nothing new, like every party in, you know, since I've ever started paying attention to politics has always said we will do, you know, better regulation for our economies. And, you know, specifically the one that I was keeping in mind on this one was Gordon Brown promising, which I think was the quote, was light touch regulation for the financial sector in the early 2000s. Because, you know, Finance UK in the London City are the engine.
How did that work out?
Really well. You know,
cool.
We all live.
No further questions.
And lo and behold, at the same very same summit, there's an article from Reuters. Tulip Siddiq, MP, whose actual job title, by the way, is Minister for the City or City Minister, which is great. Like the London City just has its own minister. And she's already promising in this article that the rules around banking ring fencing are going to be eased. Now, if you cast your mind back to, you know, the post-crisis era, ring fencing is the thing that you do to separate, like, your normal people bank account from the investment banking and casino side of the big banks. And we learned in 2008 and in 1929 that it is actually really quite important to keep those things, two things separate.
Okay, so take all of my money out of the bank and hide it in the house is what you're saying.
Well, I mean, I have your address, so I would urge you to to keep everything in the house. Yes.
Yeah, come and steal minus £300.
I hear you have a very nice postcard in your own house that is worth stealing as well.
Yeah, it's an antique.
So yeah, one of the regulations that this Reuters article mentions is that, like, the amount of money banks have to have in their vaults from normal customers before they even have to ring fence anything is going to be raised from $25 billion to $35 billion, which is already an inconceivably large amount of money that apparently you don't need to do anything for. And I think that's also because, like, you now have all those, like, purely online banks that don't have any physical presence anywhere. And I think it's like that kind of financial innovation that we must stimulate.
That's not financial innovation. That's tech innovation. You can't mix the two. You're talking about Monzo, Revolut, etc. They're not. No, that's not banking. That's not finance. That's tech. It's different.
Is it? Yeah. Well,
as long as
it makes extensive use of AI.
Exactly.
On the other hand, though, quote, and this is a last bit from Reuters, quote, the Bank of England, which regulates lenders, has previously said that the ring fencing rules are working satisfactorily and are not in need of a major overhaul. So if even the Bank of England says, yeah, this is something that doesn't need touching, then it's really good to see that the Labour Party is still committed to doing this. By the way, and for no particular reason, the main summit, main sponsors of the this investment summit included, among others, HSBC, Lloyds Bank, and the investment manager M&G. So I'm sure A has nothing to do with B.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, everything's above board. We know that.
Definitely.
And there's one more thing that I wanted to mention as regards this investment summit. Because
if things weren't all above board, I'm sure Robert Pesson would notice.
Yeah. Then they would simply become odd instead of regular.
Yeah.
So the last thing I wanted to mention from this is, like, because, well, it was just a giant puff piece, right? But there was one sort of bit sort of floating in amongst it that sort of, I think, also shows where, like, the Starmer idea of, like, an industrial strategy, or, like, where they see the future of, like, British investment and British, like, business going. And, like, they published this long list. No, it's AI and data centers.
Oh, fuck me. Of course it is.
I'm sorry, it's not in pharma and weight loss drugs. What?
No, you get those as a little treat.
Probably going to train an AI to give you those.
Yes. Jason Vaughn, the bouncer, is going to be AI generated.
Yeah.
And it's going to be a virtual medication that you're given, and you'll be virtually thin, not really thin.
Yeah, what if they put job centres in the holodeck?
On the what deck?
In the holodeck.
Yeah, from TV Star Trek.
sorry.
If David was here, he'd be so furious right now.
I can do a few Quantum Leap quotes, but that's about it. Sorry, David.
what we should do is sort of put it in the metaverse is why don't we get a bunch of those like Elon Musk robot butlers and equip them with, you know, the air rifles filled with weight loss drug. I think at that point we'll just be settled for life.
Yeah, but in the metaverse, everyone's going to have a job, so it won't be a problem there.
Yeah,
that's true, and no legs, so like that's half your body weight already, like basically gone. So you know. Then...
Oh my god, I'd totally forgotten about that.
But yeah, like I was saying, like they published this long list of these are all the companies that are, you know, investing in Britain and it's all going to be wonderful, blah blah. And there were like basically there were two lines of companies. The first line was a big wad of renewable energy and wind farms and that carbon capture use and storage bullshit that you guys talked about last week, which I imagine are also going to be partly used because data centers are famously incredibly energy intensive and the UK grid is, you know, simply doesn't have the capacity to, you know, to feed all these data centers.
Yeah.
But yeah, like I said, so the big thing, the big headline ones.
Sorry, I was just going to say, I'm feeling a bit conspiracy theorist because renewable energy is also, isn't that where Charles has most of his investments in as well?
Yeah, that's because the Crown Estate owns all the seabed off the coast of the UK. So it's not necessarily his investments, it's just his property as the Crown.
Ah, big difference. Sorry. Noted.
They're going to build. There's a list of all these data centers, and you know, all it was in the press release. It was all like linked to AI. The big one, of course, is the famously cursed British vault site at Blyth. They're going to be given $10 billion. Blackstone, the investment company, I think, is going to pay £10 billion to. Create like a gigantic warehouse, a data center there. They promise 4,000 jobs, which I don't think is true. But already 1,200 of those are like only for the construction. So then it's down to 2,800. And then I was just reminded that British Ford was also promising 2,500 local jobs.
Do you think they just copied their numbers?
I genuinely think so. Yeah. Amazon, by the way, you'll be pleased to hear, is also promising £8 billion worth of investment, but even more jobs. But they're promising even 14,000 whole jobs. That's a lot of jobs. But quote the press release. See if. But that does include quote at local businesses. So okay. I think what Amazon's trying to say is if we build the big data warehouse and like more. Local shops use like Amazon Web Services for their web shop. I think they might be counting those.
Makes sense, right?
Absolutely.
They're job creators after all.
Well, I mean, and the most significant one, because I think that's sort of the underlying thing of all of this, is another company called CloudHQ, which says we're going to build another data center. They do say we're going to deliver 1,500 jobs. Those are only for the construction, though. They do say that they will only deliver 100 jobs once operational, and I think that's much closer to the truth.
Yeah.
Because, well, like, once a data center is...
You can't have a job in the cloud. You just fall out.
No, but the point is, like, once a data center is operational and, like, running in the cloud, then, like, the amount of staff, or especially the amount of, like, skilled staff in there is low. Like, you need a couple of people to, like, fix the occasional server blade, but for the rest, like, it's security guards and janitors. Like, that's it. That's the jobs.
Yeah. If something actually breaks, like, with the internet, then you've just got to call, like, some guy who lives off-site and earns, like... you know, six figures to come out and plug it back in.
Yeah, and also like
people
all
the on-site plug it back in because they're not insured.
But also like all the people who like you know, make the real money doing, you know, cool whiz-bang startups. They're not going to be based out of Blyth or anything like that. They're not going to be in the north of England. No. They're all going to be where they are now. And, you know, now there's just more cloud server capacity for them to use. It doesn't matter where on earth these people live. Like, it's not, you know, you're not going to create like a new, whatever, like knowledge economy or something out of this, because they don't need to. This is like that level of tech bullshit is so mobile that they can, you know, they can live in the Bitcoin city in El Salvador or in California or wherever.
Yeah. Exactly. If you do want to create a knowledge economy, though, you need to open a bunch of like pop-up colleges to deal with people on like 10 billion people.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Also, like, I want to stop talking about AI and this bullshit now. But like, there was one more thing, because like we talked about that's related to this, because we talked about a couple of weeks ago. We talked about the Starmer government getting all those free shit, and I distinctly remember Alistair saying, Why has everybody in the Labour front bench gotten free tickets to see Taylor Swift? And Politico posted a good article about it, and the mystery's been solved. Because, like, right, they did give out a lot of tickets, like free Taylor Swift tickets in particular. And that's because currently the government is considering regulation to make it, like, a lot easier for AI companies to train on copyrighted material and not have to pay anybody. And naturally the UK and like global music industry, which, you know, the creative industry in the UK is enormous, doesn't like that. So what they did, no, you know, is simply invite a few people to a concert. And again, I'm genuinely not saying that that's a bribe. What they're doing is like building a relationship so that when push comes to shove with this regulation about AI training models, you know, they can pick up the phone and whoever they invited to the concert is like, oh, I had a nice time with so and so, you know, I'll hear them out. So that's sort of that particular mystery for us.
Like Taylor Swift as well, who famously didn't she remove her music from Apple Music because they weren't paying her the right royalties or something?
It might have been Spotify, but yeah, she did.
So the irony of that as well, like, she really stands for her rights of copywriting. And yes, I am also a Taylor Swift fan, not just Rob. yeah, to invite them to that concert as opposed to any other.
Yeah. I mean, I think they also like gave out tickets to like a bunch of other things, but like this one was obviously the main headline one. So yeah, like that solved that particular mystery. So, you know, Britain's AI future and its data center future is like looks good. I can't see anything going wrong.
I'm so depressed right now. I'm just like, I'm looking at these numbers and how few jobs will be created in thanks to these data centers, and then I'm like, but then we need renewable energy, so maybe some jobs will be created then, but then it's like a vicious circle, yeah. And then the jobs will get less and less,
and also the thing to always ask whenever anyone says, yo, this giving this rich prick $20 billion or pounds or like whatever will create X jobs, you've got to ask, yeah, but are those jobs shit? Because invariably the jobs are shit.
Yeah.
Yep, that's true.
And also, like, genuinely, I'm always like, well, we give them X billion for like Y number of jobs. I'm like, well, if you just divide like the number of people you say they're going to get jobs, and like, why can't you just give them, you know, an equal portion of those billions instead? And they might do something better and more fun with it, essentially.
Okay, but have those unemployed people who you're proposing to give the money to ever given anyone from Labour Taylor Swift tickets?
Not so far as I know, no.
Well, then they can get fucked.
All right. Well, on that note, we're going to leave you here for a moment and, you know, take you forward in time or backward in time or sideways through time. And you'll get to hear us talk to Phil Burton Cartledge. But then afterwards, the three of us will be back for Comment or Commentariat. So see you in a bit.
Yeah.
This is an ad break on Podcasting as Praxis. This advert is for the Patreon of Podcasting is Praxis. On the Patreon of Podcasting is Praxis, you will get at least 2 monthly bonus episodes of Podcasting is Praxis, where we discuss lots of topics, including new types of guy, celestial boondoggles, monetizing whale shit, and reluctantly, Scott Paul. You will also be able to join the Podcasting is Praxis Discord, a place to talk with like-minded people about lots of topics, including new types of guy, celestial boondoggles, monetizing whale shit, but not Scott Paul, and also, of course, Podcasting is Praxis. If that isn't enough Podcasting is Praxis for you, the Discord also includes a bonus channel where we post the bits that don't make the final cut of the episodes. Fans of both mediocre and bad podcasting have everything to gain by subscribing to the Patreon of Podcasting is Praxis. You will also no longer get ads on episodes of Podcasting is Praxis. £5 a month will get you all of that and maybe more at patreon.com/, you guessed it, PraxisCast. That's patreon.com/ PraxisCast, the place where we sell Podcasting is Praxis.
All right, and welcome back. It's time for our main segment. And for this bit, we are joined by Phil Burton Cartledge. Like I said in the introduction, he's a lecturer in sociology at Derby University, the author of a very good book, The Party's Over, and also the what I think is a must-read blog, which is The Very Public Sociologist at blogspot.co.uk. Phil, thank you very much for joining us and talking about the strange goings on in the Tory party, if you know the stories from conference were to be believed.
A most dubious pleasure.
So I wanted to talk, before we get into like conference and the future of the Tory party, I wanted to sort of go back a little bit and sort of start where I think this story sort of ought to start, which is to say that like the last election wasn't won by the Labour Party, but it was certainly lost by what I can only call like an implosion of the Tory party. I think that is that about the size of it?
Yeah, I think so. I think that's a very fair characterisation. And I think that even you could find people in the Labour Party, on the Labour right, in their more honest moments would concede that. You know, the idea that Labour have got themselves a sandcastle majority, as a number of people have called it. And it was really the Tories that lost it rather than that Labour won it. And we can just see that in the numbers of seats that the Conservatives lost because the Reform vote was greater than the difference between Labour and Reform. And the same goes to Liberal Democrats as well. Now, Liberal Democrat vote more or less stayed the same, but they were able to win 72 seats. Again, Reform made a key difference in a lot of those places.
Yeah, what I find interesting is like when you look at the history of it, so sort of going from Boris Johnson to the current moment, is that like when Boris won in 2019, I mean, apart from sort of the all-out media war against Jeremy Corbyn, of course, the main thing was Brexit, but he won with such a sort of convincing majority that I think I and a lot of other people just sort of thought, well, this will be sort of it now for a while. You know, the Tories have once again managed the seemingly impossible trick of reinventing themselves. You know, David Cameron had the hug a hoodie thing, which turned into austerity. And I thought, well, now this, you know, Tory party's played out. But then he managed to sort of weld the Leave identity into a Tory constituency. And was that ever going to go anywhere, do you think? Or is that sort of just sort of something that I had in my head for a long time?
Well, I mean, I don't blame anyone for thinking that. Nearly everyone thought that the Tories were going to be in a long period of time, because convention shows that when a Conservative Party wins that big, and last time it did so was in the 1980s, you know, it takes a lot of time to wedge them out of office. And it did seem as though Johnson had welded together, you know, a pretty solid coalition, mostly of, as I've argued previously, elderly people and a few others. But at the end of it, because elderly people are more likely to come out and turn out to vote, you're going to be waiting a long time for those declinist tendencies that I talk about in my book to really arrest themselves. I think I remember in the first edition of the book, well before Boris Johnson blew up his own premiership and before Liz Truss was a glint in the Chaos Agent's eye, that that the Conservatives were still going to be likely be competitive for the 2024 general election, but it's after that that they would start being, you know, the declinist tendencies would really, really start to bite their voter coalition. But that presumed that it was going to be a gentle gradient of decline. And what we saw, of course, was a complete collapse of the Tories' position. It began under Boris Johnson. The work was completed by Liz Truss, and the decline was consolidated by Rishi Sunak.
Yeah, I mean,
what a decline it was.
Yeah.
It was like a political stock market falling, basically.
Yeah. For me, this is sort of one of my sort of perennial objects of fascination, because you also mention it in the new edition of the book, but that, like, and I want to get back to sort of what you were talking about with the general decline in a bit, but, like, part of what I always thought was going to arrest this was this concept of that even the Tories in their manifestos and in their sort of public pronunciations had recognized that sort of the industrial strategy or the political economy of Britain, like, was essentially dead, that it was it is just London, and then, you know, the rest of the country is kind of a workforce, like a hinterland with a reserve workforce, and which is why I've always found the leveling up thing so fascinating, because it was like the Tories sort of trying to do social policy in a way, and sort of almost industrial strategy, I mean, badly and within the limits of their own sort of conception of capitalist politics. But I mean, do you think that and I want to get onto the future, but this is just one of these things that fascinates me. It's like, do you think leveling up was ever like anything real that they put thought in, because they realized they had a problem and realized that they had to, like, sort of keep their new working class, ex-Labour, however you want to call it, northern constituencies alive? Or was it always just kind of a slapdash panacea?
I think what happened with levelling up was it was a victim of Tory factionalism, effectively. I do think, you know, Boris Johnson believes whatever he says at that particular moment in time. But the thing is, when you look at the, you know, Boris Johnson did take it seriously in that he appointed Michael Gove as the levelling up secretary. Now, regardless of what you might think of Michael Gove, and I imagine that listeners of this podcast aren't amongst his biggest fans, but speaking to people who've had interactions with Gove and dealt with him in a professional capacity when he was Minister of State, they always found that he was someone who was properly on top of his brief, took suggestions seriously, and was someone who knew how to drive the Whitehall machine to meet the objectives that he set for them. So obviously Johnson wanted this to happen. But the problem was, and this is, I mean, I do find this is entirely fascinating as well, and I'll be interested to read Sunak's memoirs when they come out. The fact that Sunak's rise was basically entirely because of Johnson. Johnson promoted him. He didn't have any base independent of Johnson. And yet when he became the Chancellor, and after that Sunak mania, or, you know, Dishy Rishi nonsense in the...
The Superman thing during Corona.
That's it. Oh, yeah, all that rubbish. You know, the horrendous memories. Thing. But the... But he was very much... No, he started acting as an independent agent. He was very sceptical about the levelling up. He was truly wedded to the model of, you know, the London versus the rest hinterland vision of British political economy.
And the sort of treasury brain thing, you mean?
That's right. Because, you know, Sunak is from the city, and he embodies a lot of the interests, literally in his case because of his family background and who he's married to. And also he embodies the interests of financial capital in the cabinet. And of course, being, you know, having city brain as well, and treasury brain and Bank of England brain all melded into one, for him, his worry was that if the state is used by Gove or Johnson to actually do things, people will suddenly start noticing that, oh, look, we can actually put pressure on the government to actually get them to fix our, you know, fix our potholes, or, you know, nationalise our local hospital, or mend this broken infrastructure.
Yeah, do some bus routes in rural That's constituencies. Right. Act. Yeah, yeah.
It puts demands on the state. It gives an illusion. It gives a kind of a, it creates expectations that the state is there to do things. And of course, as a good Tory small statist, you know,
yeah,
Sunak did not want to be held, or did not want his party to be held accountable or for having to do anything. And so he derailed it, him and his faction derailed those schemes that Gove and Johnson were in favour of. I mean, Johnson didn't really care anyway, but Gove certainly did. But, you know, Gove's stock in the Tory party was fatally damaged when he backstabbed Johnson in the back all those many, many moons ago after the...
Yeah, right after the referendum when they were both going for leader post-Cameron. I was just trying to place...
And that's the gist.
Although I always think with Gove, I always just kind of think, like, you know, that old, you know, I mean, it's sort of the Aesop's fable that's been revived for the internet age. Like with Gove, I always just thought, you know, it's just like Law set the scorpion Lamau. Like, it's just kind of, you know, like he was Gove was always going to do something like that, because that's chronically him, basically. But one more thing, and then we will move on. I do want to sort of get your brief impression, like, if I look back on like the last 2 years of the Tories under Sunak, I never got any sense that he really wanted that job, or sort of was the dog, you know, who caught the car and didn't then know what to do with it. But like, what was he to you as a sort of more professional Tory observer than the rest of us? Like, what was he trying to do? Was he even trying to do something?
His project was to just effectively to maintain the status quo, and that status quo was the one that triumphed under Johnson, i.e. do not, you know, keep everything ticking over, try and demobilise the working class as much as possible, and don't accede to any demands that bubble up from below. So try and kind of manage expectations, try to kind of effectively run down the state, reduce the capacity of the state so people stop seeing the state as a solution to their problems. And that, you know, and that serves the kind of the class interest that he and the Tories, or his faction of the Tories, effectively represent. You know, they don't want to be held to account. They don't have to do anything. All they want to do is just carry on making money, making sure that, you know, they keep clipping those coupons in the city. They're not bothered about the rest of the country. You know, it can go to seed for all they care. And of course, you know, by winding down the, you know, public services, particularly the NHS, you know, it gives them opportunities to create that two-tier health service where people who can afford to opt out the NHS do so. So it creates a new market for their mates in the city and for international capital and so on. So it was all about, again, a very much a two-nation Toryism, but a two-nation Toryism that, unlike Thatcher, which she had to actively go ahead to create, Sunak has done just by doing nothing. And so he was kind of seen as the safe pair of hands that could oversee this sort of, you know, this incredibly dismal prospectus. And he did so, you know, for 2.5 years. Was it, or was it 18 months? I do forget. 18 months.
Yeah, I could. The details of that one escaped me as well, which sort of leads neatly into you know, then Sunak losing. Obviously, we have Labour in charge now. But I think also what you saw at the time under Boris already, and then continuing straight through, but certainly in sort of the latter half of Sunak, is that underneath that sort of lackadaisical, terrible administration, the Tory party itself was sort of growing increasingly unhinged and into culture wars, and really into sort of economic thinking as well, that we saw under Truss, but it's still sort of rampant throughout the Tory party now, is that like the party and the sort of the parliamentary party as well is essentially becoming more and more unhinged as it, I think also because it is getting smaller, which sort of leads us to conference and sort of the current choice being between Robert Jenrick and Cammy Badenoch, who both in their own way seems to be completely lost in this fog of, we have to keep the you know, the people who, the reform switchers on side, and who just sort of have seemed to sort of, rather than, utilize culture wars to some sort of greater sort of project to sort of see that as an actual goal of itself?
Yeah, they've kind of, they have lost sight of, I mean, for Johnson and for Sunak as well, that these were always means to an end. Whereas, of course, now for Jenrick and Badenoch, they appear to be ends in and of themselves. And I can understand from one perspective why it has become so, because when you look at what Badenoch and Jenrick are offering, they're effectively just offering exactly the same as what Sunak offered, but with added racism, with added xenophobia and added scapegoating. There's nothing there at all that they're offering. So they're quite, you know, they're sanguine about the model, the political economy that they that, if you like, Sunak bequeathed them. But there's nothing else apart from that. They are both offering leaderships that are designed entirely to take on reform and not really take on Labour. Now, some people in mainstream political science, I'm thinking particularly about Tim Bale here, who's also written an interesting and worthwhile reading, it's worthwhile reading this history of the Conservative Party. But the problem is that he always saw the early period when Ian Duncan Smith took over after William Hague in 2001 as the Conservative Party just going mad and insane. But it's not, I don't think we should see these pathologies as a symptom of insanity that just can't be explained. It's just a result of silliness. And
No. I think it's a logical process how they got to where they are now. But yeah.
But also it's about them trying to consolidate their base, because as per 1997, they've had this huge shock, their worst defeat ever. And so they need to consolidate their base. And of course, what they've got now to contend with that they didn't have back in 1997 was this viable alternative to the right. And also a lot of Tories can just do the simple arithmetic and you just have to look and say, well, Labour are doing badly at the moment because, of course, they've plunged in the polls, you know, the geniuses that are in charge seem to have taken their eye off those balls and they don't care. But they can just go, oh, well, you know, all we need to do is, if you just add the Conservative vote up with the Reform vote, if we're somehow able to merge them, then we'll trounce Labour at the next election. And there's an element of rationality there. It's not going to work, but I can understand where they're coming from.
No, I can understand it as well. But what I find interesting is I always thought that Boris could certainly do it because he had that sort of personal appeal as well, and people projected a lot into him. Certainly, sort of the moderate voter, sort of either not necessarily like a Tory Lib Dem swing voter, but people who are not necessarily motivated by all the cultural stuff. David Cameron was, of course, the master at it with the hugger hoodie and that sort of, you know, call me Dave whole thing. But this now, like when you see the highlights from conference, I've just taken a few. Some of them I you know, stole from your very good blog, and some of them were just things that I, you know, saw around. But, you know, Robert Jenrick wearing the Hamas's terrorism jumper, Kemi Badenoch's sort of platform, which seriously includes reference to cultural Marxism and the long march through the institutions, the getting into, I know it was a side event, but the Breed for Britain discourse while saying that maternity patient exists. And like, I understand their need to appeal to the base, but is there, you know, was James Cleverly sort of the last person saying, actually, for anybody who's not fully inside the tent and like sort of had their, you know, is a pensioner who had their brain cooked by being on Facebook, essentially, is there anybody who, you know, still is saying, but these are not, this is not viable for, you know, like you can get certainly like a very hardcore minority fully on board with this, but, you know, these people aren't Trump either.
No, I mean, this is the interesting thing, because they seem to think, you can understand conservatives who might say, well, look, Boris Johnson won in 2019 and he did so on a right wing platform to get Brexit done, but also get all these other things done as well. But, you know, he happily scapegoated people. He engaged in culture wars and he was popular. But the problem is that Boris Johnson had a certain kind of personality, which, as you know, appeals to a large range of people. If you look at someone like Jenrick, Jenrick is as colourless and as you know, uninspiring as Rishi Sunak is. Though Rishi Sunak does have a good line in dry gags sometimes at Prime Minister's questions. I can't imagine Jenrick ever telling a joke. Never mind.
Oh, God.
Telling one at
I'm PMQs. Trying to imagine like a PMQs between Robert Jenrick and Keir Starmer and just like wanting to just...
terrible.
Oh.
Excruciating. And then you got Badenoch, who people seem to think is a bit of a character because... She can be a bit spiky in interviews, but she's completely charmless and lacks
yes.
any kind of wit, any kind of charisma. You know, just being rude to Laura Koonsberg on a Sunday morning is, well, that's not going to kind of cut the mustard where swing voters are concerned. And no, most reform voters are not going to be tuning in
no.
to listen to what she has to say there. So both of them are completely ill-suited for the job. And you're right, you know, Cleverly was at best their last gasp. They had a slim chance, I think, of being able to get back into the mainstream, win some of those Liberal Democrat voters back from the Lib Dems, unsurprisingly, and make a fist of it. But of course, you know, had he won, there would have been problems too. But nevertheless, I think that they have shot their bolt. And I mean, even today you had Penny Mordaunt requesting that some kind of photo of her and Jenrick that he's been using in the campaign, and she's requested that he stop using it because she doesn't want to have anything to do with him in the awful campaign that he's running. And Penny Mordaunt's out of Parliament as well, you know, obviously the chances of getting a plum job or something. It's just incredible. So I was just going to say, you've got this situation where you've got this two-thirds, one-third parliamentary party where two-thirds are utterly... who seem to think that going far right or hard right is the answer, and only one third, who I would hesitate to call One Nation or relatively sensible, but do seem to realise that you do need to win voters from outside a right-wing bloc in order to win. And they're very much in the minority. So, you know, that's a contemporary Tory party for you.
Yeah. Which sort of leads me sort of neatly onto like the second problem that I sort of see with the Tory parties is... this podcast, and I know you, Phil, as well, have like significant problems with the Labour parties, but one thing they do, at least for now, seem to have rather successfully done, which is sort of eaten the Tories' lunch by being the new centre-right party and having all the incentives to offer to the multinational corporate class, which is always where a lot of the big donor and the money show for the Tories came from. And I sort of was just thinking, like, if I'm now, I don't know, the head of public relations for HSBC or, you know, some big multinational London City-based thing, you look at the current Tory party and you say, well, apart from that, these people are not in power and, you know, I'll give them some money just on the off chance, but, you know, there are limits. It's like you would also look at it sort of from that sort of multinational careerist perspective and say, well, these people are now talking about putting 10% of all bureaucrats in prison for imaginary crimes. Why should I give money to that? Because the Tory party, even more than the current Labour party, is incredibly opaque with how it is actually funded, given how few members it has.
Yes, absolutely. There's no incentive really to back the Tories. I mean, you know, during the dog days, when Labour's down on its luck, it can at least always rely on the trade unions to provide a steady stream of income. But when the Tories are down on their luck, they are really, really broke. I mean, again, if you look back at Tory history, particularly after 1997, it was Lord Ashcroft that saved them from insolvency because their debts were so bad. You have this ridiculous system in the Conservative Party where it's usually cash rich in the run-up to an election, and then it's really scrimping and saving in between elections. And I can see that they're going to have that problem again. I mean, you will have people like Ashcroft, who is, you know, dyed-in-the-wool Tory. He'll continue to, you know, throw money at the Conservative Party. And you have, you know, a few people like the Bamford family of JCB fame, who will always throw money at the Conservative Party as well. And maybe, who knows, maybe Rishi Sunak, when he inevitably resigns from Parliament and goes off to California, maybe he'll remember to send a few remittances to the Tories as well. But just, in terms of kind of monopolising, you know, the era of big money for the Tories for the time being is over, because Labour is where the action's at. And if you want to get your nose in the trough, I wouldn't be joining the Tory party now.
No, but I wanted to talk about, you already mentioned it a few times at the start, I wanted to go into, which you've been saying since forever, and I do mostly agree with you, is the sort of the big, maybe even unsolvable structural problem for the Tory party as it exists and as it has existed for the last 30 years, is that essentially by pulling up the economic and especially the housing ladder so hard since basically the Thatcher era, they have pretty much destroyed their voting base, because they've always been reliant on sort of older homeowners to sort of secure themselves majorities. But like you look around now, and every demographic in the world tells you that even people in their 40s in the UK now don't own homes, don't have assets, they're not quote unquote maturing into the Tory party anymore. So is this now such a, like, have we reached a sort of terminal tipping point, do you reckon? Or,
well, I mean, there's no such thing as iron laws in politics, and these things can be switched around, but it always depends on how the Tory party acts. I think the Tories are really in a, you know, from an outsider, it's a really interesting position for the Tories to be in, because if they go towards the centre to try and address these questions, there's always the problem that firstly, they will alienate some of their existing base, which they can't afford to do, because that's what's keeping them in power, you know, keeping them in office. It's still making them a kind of a force to be reckoned with, at least electorally speaking. So they go towards the centre and they can alienate its base. But also you've got this problem of, even if they did move to the centre right now, that there are plenty of people in the mainstream who would like not touch them with a barge pole. I can't imagine many Labour voters. I mean, poll after poll is showing that some people are saying, you know, a lot of voters say are disappointed with Labour, some are regretting their votes and so on. But there weren't that many Tory Labour switchers at the general election, and that's part of the problem that Labour have got. You know, a lot of them went to reform instead.
Yeah, and so, I mean, that was the whole that was the whole pitch. That was the whole hero voter Morgan McSweeney thing. Is that we must get these Tory switchers, but either they didn't exist, or they went to reform, or, and that's my other bet, they all just stayed home.
Yeah. That's it. But even if the Tories did pitch more towards the centre, let's say towards those Liberal Democrat voters that they lost, that there's no way that some people are going to go, all right, okay, I'm going to forget what's happened over these last 14 years and we're going to give you a punt. I mean, when you've still got people who continue to vote Conservative or will not vote Labour because of what happened over the winter of discontent of 1978-79, like my own mum, and I hear
that's,
it every
wow.
time.
Wow, that's a serious commitment to the bit.
But you see Tories, like all Tories on Twitter, still bang on about it as well. So it's very much part of their mythology still. You know, can't bury the dead, and you know, rubbish piling up in the streets. I mean, rubbish was piling up in the streets during the austerity years of Cameron and well into the Theresa May era. We never hear about that, but that's the media for it. But that's all by and by. So yeah, the Tories
it is the media as well, though, isn't it? It's like they bang on about that for so much because we've had 40 years of the papers banging on about it.
That's it. And the media, of course, you know, older people disproportionately dependent on legacy media. And so the legacy media effectively works as a mobiliser of old people around these myths. So we can laugh about Facebook radicalisation and so on. But it is really the legacy media that's done a number on older people. And that's what turns them out at elections. But that also means that the Tories are trapped as well, because in order for them to overcome their toxicity and start recruiting new generations of voters, they're going to have to break with the kinds of politics that currently holds their coalition together. And if they don't, then more and more decline sits in their future. So it's not like they've lost the election, okay, blank slate, let's start again. It's they've lost the election, they're at a low point, but the process of decline has not finished with them yet.
Yeah, I mean, and that's what I find so interesting as well, is as you say, like, they cannot... they can't sort of refurbish their party in a sort of economic sense to make a proper offer. But is there, I mean, you look at the Tory party now, because back when they were in government, they could at least do things like the help to buy and the, you know, sort of the sort of supplementary schemes to help at least a few young people buy a home. But you look at the Tory party now, and I mean, without trying to give them too much of, say, electoral advice, basically, but is there anything that they, any sort of material, because we are materialists here, is there anything material that they would be able to offer younger voters in terms of houses or wages or, you know, pick a card, any card?
I mean, there was a brief point during the election where I thought when they said that they were going to put up the pension by £1,000 per year, I thought, well, that's it. That's a really strong offer. But I kind of misinterpreted it as some, like, it'll be worth £1,000 more by something like 2030 or something like that under the Tories. But, you know, that would have really consolidated their, if they said, right, we're going to put state pension up by £1,000 this year, and then £1,000 next year, and £1,000 a year after that, that would have really consolidated that old people vote. And it would have prevented them from doing a lot of, you know, losing a lot of what they lost. In terms of appealing to young people, I cannot see what they can possibly do, because young people generally, if they're not kind of switched off from politics already, just will not believe a single word of what the Tories will do. Because, you know, regardless of what you think about Brexit, young people disproportionately voted for Remain. Tories campaigned against it and delivered it. And a lot of younger people saw the European Union as part of their future, as being in their material interest because of the stability and opportunities and the instability that Brexit offered and all the rest of it. And so the Tories have got that hanging around their neck. Of course, they've got the kind of whole Boris Johnson being absolutely awful hanging around their neck. And they've got the Liz Truss experience hanging around their neck as well, where her actions put X number of pounds on everybody's mortgage. So yeah. I really can't see how the Tories could possibly make an offer to young people that does not break from their current politics. Plus, they'd have to as well show that they mean it, because it's very well saying, well, we're for this, we're for that. But they need to show a record of delivery. So you'd expect, I don't know, if you have Conservative councils, or perhaps because you've got the Tories in Scotland in Holyrood, you've got their election coming up in just under 2 years' time. If they kind of pivoted in a particular way towards a modernising agenda, and by modernising agenda, I mean something that is socially liberal, that breaks decisively with the scapegoating politics, and also has a strong material offer to working age people around house building, perhaps around cheap public transport,
or even maybe childcare. Yeah. If they're on this whole, like, we must have more babies thing, like, you know, that.
Yes. Childcare, universities, tuition, you know, all, if they had a big infrastructure offer that would force Labour to compete with them on that, then I think they might have a chance. But again, for the Tories to get there, they have to bloodlet quite massively.
The best offer they're ever likely to give is that, like, you know, when you're conscripted to serve in some billionaire's, like, post-apocalyptic bunker, your bomb collar has an extra 30 seconds on the fuse or something like that.
But I think one of the reasons that the Tories won't essentially modernize in this way and sort of find a new offer for young people or a sort of a new working age people is because of Reform and Nigel Farage, who has existed since the dawn of time, I think, to sort of keep the Tories on the right and push them even further right where he can. But I was just interested to see as to whether or not you think, like, that Reform is now actually, they have five MPs now. It's, you know, it's more than they've ever had. Are they now something real in British politics, or is it still a protest vote against everything? And, you know, is there a possibility that I don't think that Reform and the Tories will merge, but is there a possibility that, like, Reform ends up overtaking the Tories or eating the Tories in some manner? But I'm very curious about that.
I mean, it is very difficult to say. I mean, yeah, I think reform, unfortunately, are here to stay for the time being. And that's simply because you just have to look across other similar party systems across Western Europe and how every party system has a, you know, a quote-unquote normal centre-right party and then a populist come extreme right-wing party to its right as well. So I suppose we're just catching up with the rest of the continent in that regard. Though of course we've had UKIP and the Brexit Party before that. But are they a stable formation? I mean, because I'm really sad, as you probably know, I track local council by-elections, and it's only really this year. It's dedication to my craft, you might say. And it's only this year, and particularly since the election, that Reform have started taking those council by-elections seriously. And I've always believed that they're important because they show you the strength of the game that the parties have got on the ground and how well they're able to mobilise in between elections at these very, very low turnout elections and what their votes are like and so on. And what interests me about them is that all throughout the last period of polling, the kind of the popular vote of every month's worth of by-elections were around about, you know, about 25% for the Conservatives and usually below 35% or thereabouts for Labour. And what do you know, the actual general election sort of reflected that, those kind of low votes as well. But I've kind of gone off the point a bit. Reform have started taking these seriously. Reform never really bothered with council by-elections, unlike UKIP before 2017. UKIP was a regular feature of these council by-elections and it was able to build up a head of steam there. And so now they're starting to take it more seriously. So you are seeing branches being formed. You are seeing that they are taking to and winning, going into by-elections. And they've actually started winning by-elections as well. I think they've won two seats now since July, which isn't bad going for a new entrant into the market, if you like. So I think the support is real enough. But I do agree with you that they do have some of the features of the Conservative vote in that, again, they have a very limited appeal to younger people, that they are effectively a party that has been born into long-term decline because their support base, which tends to be slightly younger than the Conservative Party, but is mostly white men, and white men of a certain age, usually between their mid-50s all the way up until their 70s. And so that is not going to reproduce itself either over the long term. But as you say, it's something that the Tories feel like they've got to bend towards. And of course, as the Tories bend towards it by electing either Jenrick or Badenoch, that runs the risk of dragging the rest of politics further to the right as well. Because of course, you know, Keir Starmer would just love the chance to go even further to the right, say, oh, we can't afford to do that. Oh no, look, there's some awful immigrants over there. Let's, you know, stick them in, let's export them to Albania.
Yeah, I always think with that is that if the function of Farage, and whether or not it was UKIP or the Brexit Party or Reform, is to drag the Tories right, then the Tories drag Labour right, and then you sort of end up, you know, with the whole spectrum with the Overton window sort of as a whole sort of moving over. But and then I think this will be the last question, because I know you have limited time, is, and that's sort of on the other end of the spectrum, is like, does that then leave more space on the left and the sort of soft left, the social democratic left, to either for the Greens to really make a grab for something if they can get their house in order, or for something organic and new to exist? Or is that still, I mean, that's always been the conversation on the left, is, you know, I think a lot of people who have also abandoned the Labour Party, I think a lot of them also for good, after certainly with the sort of whiplash from Corbyn to Starmer. But does all this movement right create space on the left, or how do you see that?
Yes, it absolutely does. I mean, the space is there, it's gaping at the moment. But of course, it's all very well for there to be a space on the left, but there has to be something to fill it. And of course, the Green Party are trying their damnedest to fill it, and they're doing not a bad job of it. You know, they've got four MPs now. They do consistently well in local council by-elections. They've got over 800 councillors. And even though, you know, they've kind of backtracked on certain things, so they're now, these days, of course, they're pro-NATO. But on other things, they've moved further to the left. So they've got quite a left-wing economic programme. They explicitly tout for left-wing support. They've been pretty good, I think, on kind of Israel-Palestine issues as well. They're certainly better than any of the other parties in the mainstream. But of course, there are plenty of people who won't go near the Greens, because ultimately, you know, they're not a working class party. They're not a party that puts class struggle at the heart of their politics. And even though Labour, for all the awful things that we think about the Labour Party, the fact that it exists and has that link to the organised workers movement indicates that there is still that, it indicates that there is that class relationship still there. But also what we're seeing as well, and I haven't written on this yet, so my thoughts are a bit hazy, but amongst the Labour Party as well, you've got Morgan McSweeney, who's now kind of enjoying his supremacy in Number 10 Downing Street. You know,
Keir Starmer's fixer. That's no, it's always a mistake for the vizier behind the throne to step into.
That's
the spotlight.
It. But his project is not just to kind of maintain things, but effectively his side project is stop Angela Rayner, because Angela Rayner, again, even though she's been happy to go along with the Starmer project, she was equally happy to go along with the Corbyn project for a time as well. So she's a kind of that true sort of weather vane type of character, as opposed to signpost that Tony Benn famously spoke of. But her natural politics are, you know, soft pro-working class, pro-trade union, pro we need to nationalise some things. And that is obviously not where Starmerism is. And that's certainly not where any of the heir apparents are as well. So part of this move to the left, then this is what will be worrying Morgan McSweeney, is as the gap to the left grows, that means that that will be felt within the Labour Party too. And that when Starmer goes, and presumably Angela Rayner makes her pitch for the top job, that means that he's effectively got to manoeuvre Labour between now and then into such a position that Rayner and her like Louise Hague, who Starmer threw under a bus this week, the Transport Minister, they got to make sure that soft left don't cohere and offer an alternative to what, you know, what they want, which will be some kind of continuity under Wes Streeting or Rachel Reeves or some of the other horrors in cabinet. But as for a left alternative, again, that's very much in the gift of those who are best primed to do it, and that still remains Jeremy Corbyn and the people around him. And so it is, I suppose, disappointing for those who would like to see a new party that Jeremy Corbyn is very much a kind of a, I'm going to sit on the fence on this one, or we need to build strong roots in our communities, which of course we do, but you know, to build a new party, you have to have that dialectic of top down, bottom up. He's in the position to offer that lead, but he doesn't seem to be willing to offer that lead. And I can understand why. Who at his age wants to have to deal with 57 varieties of sectarians fighting it out in his new party? Because of course, you know, for all the new forces that will be drawn into it, there'll be some old hands too.
No, I think what you'll find is that, you know, people on the left always easily agree on things, and that's never a problem. All right, I think we've kept you long enough. Thank you so much again for coming on and talking about us. And I know I mentioned it up front, but if people would like more Phil in their lives, and they should, because I genuinely read your blogs pretty much the day they come out. So where can they find more Phil, or buy more Phil even?
Oh, well, okay. So The Party's Over, The Rise and Fall of the Conservatives from Thatcher to Sunak is available at all good bookshops, or you can get it directly from the Verso website. And you can read my blog, All That Is Solid, on averypublicsociologist.blogspot.co.uk. As you say, usually pretty almost daily I write something. And when I'm not writing something, I will subject the poor, long-suffering viewers of the blog to examples of my music taste.
So something for everybody. All right, Phil, thank you again so much.
Hi, we're back, and we're here for another round of Comet or Cometariat. Take it over, Jamie.
Thank you. Cognitive warfare is a formal concept in Chinese military and strategic doctrine, and is also a good term for Russia's worldwide efforts to destabilize adversaries.
Its aim is
not just to mislead us over isolated events, but to change our cognition, the way we think about ourselves and the world. Compared to standard propaganda, which has always featured strongly in conflict, it is more long-term, generally deniable, very diffuse, and particularly directed at weakening the cohesion of the civilian population. Is that comment or commentariat?
I don't know. I have to do it. Do I have to ring Moscow first, or do I just get like instructions wired into my electrodes before I answer? I think that's commentariat.
I'm just hanging my head and shaking it and laughing, which I again appreciate is terrible for a podcast. I can't do this the whole game, but I'm going opposite to Rob. Comment.
That was William Hague in The Times. The next big battlefield will be in our minds.
See, if I just saw that as a headline, I'm like, neat, we're finally going to have psychers. But no, it's just fucking Vladimir Putin in my brain pan again.
Yeah. Okay. The slap back to reality is that if true, the civilization that sent that signal may well be long extinct. Until we solve faster than light travel, and I believe we eventually will, any contact that is not real time will be moot. Is that comment or commentariat?
It's got to be comment. Sorry,
darling, I interrupted you.
No, that's okay. I really like this dynamic. I really like this. Oh, sorry, darling. Hi, darling. How are you, darling? really like it. I'm going to podcast more often. I've lost exactly what the comment was. So I just think someone saying, like, traveling faster than the speed of light and everything other than real time is what, moot? Like,
yeah,
comment.
I think it's a comment, but I think it's that guy from the space cannon that we talked about with Lila.
It was a comment in the Daily Mail. Evidence of alien life could be revealed next month as NASA filmmaker claims we've found it.
Excellent.
I like that one for the bit that says, like, this, you know, the harsh reality is that the civilization that sent that signal may well be long extinct. They think it came from a star 4 light years away. It's like, wow, 4 whole years? Like, surely no civilization can stand that long.
Also, the more bleak, like, the bleak side of this one is on the other side, because, like, we've sent a bunch of, like, random tat into space, so, like, the assumption should also have to be, by the time, you know, the cool aliens get that one, we will also have finally all shuffled off.
Yeah, can in you 4 years.
They're going to fly towards Earth. They're going to hit, like, the atmosphere where all that random shit is floating, see, like, all the grossness, dead bodies that are there, and they're going to be like, yeah, hard pass and move on.
All right, next one's a bit topical, so brace yourselves. If anything, it's going to make fat people go on the sick to get free weight loss drugs. With every day, the margin of benefit between working and not working gets narrower. Is that comment or commentariat?
My soul needs it to be comment. I need it to be an individual without gravitas of writing an article. But I'm depressed enough to think it's commentariat.
No, this is commentariat.
That was a comment in the Express.
Ah, hurrah.
There's hope. There's hope in journalism yet.
The article was, grim side effects of weight loss drugs unemployed could be given in labour scheme.
Yeah. Wow.
Orwell said that the best way to control minds in a society...
I quit.
You will sit there and you will listen to this fine fucking like piece of text, and then you will tell me whether it was a comment or commentary. So shush. Orwell said that the best way to control minds in a society was to control its language first. Life on campus seems to have been overtaken by a battle using language to exert social control. The so-called tolerant, inclusive progressives have been exposed as intolerant, prejudiced, and hell-bent on excluding those who have the temerity to disagree. Unless the tide is turned, this story does not end well. We cannot allow our universities to lead society's descent into such oppression. Is that comment or commentary?
We cannot allow a free speech gap. All right, excellent.
I'm just clinging on to our dog, like just despairing about life, and I think he can sense my anxiety and my despair, and he's clinging on. Go on, Rob, you first.
This is commentary.
Yeah, I think it's commentary.
That was Suella Braverman in the Telegraph. I was cancelled by Cambridge, and Starmer's Labour bears the blame.
Sure, why not? Go nuts.
Oh my god, I'm never doing this ever again.
All right, and let's finish with some good old fashioned bigotry.
Yes.
This type of social networking is more to do with getting a message across. I don't walk around with a t-shirt saying I am straight. Is that comment or commentary?
What?
Sounds like a Trumpism. Is it not like a tweet? Not a tweet, sorry, or an X. A truth platform statement from Trump? Is that not an option?
No.
Is it just one of the two options?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Comment. Rob, are you there?
I think that's comment.
That was a comment in the Daily Mail. The article was, I was called a paedophile after sharing my wedding photos, but my wife is only 2 years younger than me.
Is she 14?
Okay,
but that is,
good to know.
That comment is specifically because the couple that got married were lesbians, and so, you know, that's, being a lesbian is the same as, like, is the equivalent of wearing a t-shirt that says, I am straight, or something. I don't speak fuckwit, so...
I'm so confused right now.
But yeah, you see, by being a lesbian, they're trying to get a message across to brainwash people or something? I don't fucking know.
I'm confused, and also I don't want to hear about this anymore.
Yeah.
I feel like I was too... I was definitely too competitive on this, and I don't think Rob and I should have... competed against each other. I didn't deliver enough content for your podcast. I was just like, oh, I need to get it right. Sorry.
We should do Missed team point. Comment or commentary at some point. That'd be a disaster. But yeah, that's it. Rob, right. Do you want to do the plugs?
Yeah, I do want to do the plugs. So we have a Patreon, patreon.com/praxiscast. We have two episodes, I say again, two episodes a month behind the paywall for you to enjoy. You can also buy our, you know, it's almost that time of Christmas, so, you know, you get your shopping in at praxiscast.tmail.com. We stream so regularly that it's almost not worth mentioning. Twitch.tv/PraxisCast. And after that, you know, I don't know. It's figure it out amongst yourselves.
Yeah. See ya.
Bye.
It's been emotional.